Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to your Father's house. Would you bow your heads and pray with me, please? Oh God, thank you for this Lord's Day, for a day when we are grateful that we live in a part of the world where the rains come down and fill up the rivers and the streams and water the crops and the gorgeous big trees. And we're thankful for the fall color. It's been so magnificent this year. You could have given us a black and white world, but instead, you gave us a technicolor world. Help us to pay attention. Thank you for this place to worship you freely, this place where we will sing and pray and listen. When this day is over, may we be ever thankful for the Lord Jesus Christ and His church. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you do me a favor and fill out the little yellow attendance card that's in the pew rack? See a number of visitors this morning. We're so glad to have you. We're not going to fill up your inbox. We're not going to text you over and over. But we do want to let you know some things about the church and tell you how grateful we are that you're here with us. I hope you'll stay and eat with us. We've got turkey and dressing and all the fixings through these doors and another set of double doors. This Wednesday night, we will not have our Wednesday night meal as we usually do, Bible study and all that because of Thanksgiving the next day. But please join us the following week and we'll gear back up. Let's see. This Friday at 10 o'clock, a group of folks will be here to decorate the church for Christmas. Lots of beautiful things to put up, and I understand even some new items that we'll put up this year. So please join them at 10 o'clock on Friday. And then I want to remind you that our 100th birthday worship service and potluck lunch is Sunday, December the 12th. We will have just one service that day and encourage you to join us for that. It will be potluck. We'll have historical displays. It's going to be a wonderful day to thank God for what He's allowed us to do in His name for 100 years. One of our elders, Kendra Bowers, is going to hit the high notes on the elders' notes, and then I'm going to come down and pray over these boxes. Good morning.
Elders' notes in your bulletins there, but I wanted to highlight, wanted to specifically thank everybody that volunteered with those boxes and the shoebox collection. We've got a ton of them here personally for our church, but they've gathered many more in the gym from all around us. And then also thank you for those that baked cookies and helped pack up those cookies to give to Gitmo. Heard it was a bumper crop this year. We had a ton of cookies to give and a huge box that was sent to Gitmo, so thank you for that. Items number 2 and 4 are kind of tied together. Our Recreation Ministry Director, Aaron Proctor, has resigned in order to accept a really cool opportunity as an assistant basketball coach at Melrose High School. In that vein, we are looking to get a new part-time young adults couples ministry director for the next year, able to afford that in part because of paying off our mortgage. So thank you all for that. The 100th birthday he talked about, and I just wanted to point out that we, as part of paying off our mortgage, we pledged to give more to missions, and we have, the elders have decided to give to 2 more agencies, Life Choices and Child Evangelism Fellowship, in the new year. Child Evangelism Fellowship is that organization that Matt Wade works for in Florida that helps children in after-school programs that have never been introduced to Jesus and don't even know who he is. So it's a really cool ministry. And if you look at the finances, we're doing really well. So thank you all for everything you've been giving.
Operation Christmas Child, I want you to stand up. If you helped with all the coming and going of the boxes and all that, would you stand up? All right. A little slow to stand up because they're tired, right? Thank you so much. All right. Let me pray over these boxes. Let's bow our heads. Oh God, thank you so very much for all the families in this church who put together these items for all these boxes. It's got to be over 100. Thank you for helping us meet that goal. And God, thank you for all the people and churches and just individuals all over the city who will bring boxes here today and tomorrow. And we pray that as they go to the kids in Asia, in Africa, in South and Central America, all over this world, that they will get a taste not only of a Christmas gift, perhaps a football, a doll, a coloring book, crayons, but most of all, that they will know the true gift, the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for Franklin Graham and his ministry. We pray your healing blessings on him as he recovers from heart surgery. Thank you for all the teams that are put together in your name and in the memory of the late Billy Graham. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning.
It's fantastic to see everybody here today with Thanksgiving coming up. It's so wonderful to see many people. You know, as you travel, just remember, try to be safe, drive well, don't let any of your family members do some crazy stuff. Please stand. Psalms 100, verse 1 in the King James Version says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands." And to me, that means it doesn't matter if it's soft or loud, good or bad. As long as you're praising the Lord and you're giving your thanks and appreciation to what God has done and, you know, Him sending His only Son, that's what matters. So please sing this morning. I will follow.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I move. I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, I am above my life. I will trust in you alone, in you alone. When you go, I'll go. Where you say, I'll say. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Where you love, I'll love. Where you serve, I'll serve. In this life I'll lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. Light unto the world, light unto my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I see, knowing I will find. All I need in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Will you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. In this life I'll lose, I will follow you.
worship this morning is taken from Psalm 100. Worship the Lord with gladness.
Come before him with joyful songs.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Give thanks to him and praise his name.
Let's continue singing together, Give Thanks.
This season has been a wonderful season in our church's life as God is sending new faces. And one of the families that's come to our church recently are the Bungers. I interviewed them, as I do now, and I do it on video, so I want to introduce you to them, and then I'll have the joy of baptizing Amy after we watch this video.
Members of our church, Amy by profession of faith and baptism, and Bob by reaffirmation of faith. And we'll talk about those three questions that I talked to you ahead of time about, and then just whatever's on your heart. If you feel like you want to share something with the congregation, let's do that. So that first question is, what brought you to Highland Heights?
Let me go first.
Yeah.
Since I followed you.
I think Jesus Christ. Mm. I believe the Lord led me here, and R.C. Sproul's had a lot to do with it. I studied him a lot, and
you've gotten really interested in Reformed theology, haven't you?
I have.
Yes, sir.
And I was raised a Baptist and professed. Well, I was a professed Baptist. I wasn't in a church for a long time, but I was still a Baptist. But I'm still a Baptist in some ways. But I've got some Armenian left in me, but I got a lot of. I can't think of the guy.
Calvin.
I got a lot of that in me too.
And got some Calvinism in you.
Yeah.
It'll kind of push that Arminianism out.
Yeah. And another reason that I like to come here is when I found out that it was a military, that it was, you know, we had a lot of military affiliation.
Yes, sir.
And I like military people. I like other people too, but, you know, and I like the way they think, and I know them, you know.
Yes, sir.
So anyway, that was a plus, and then it's proved out to be a good choice so far.
Amy, what about you? What brought you to Highland Heights?
Well, Bob had been coming for maybe a month or a month and a half, I guess, And when he'd come home, he talked to me about it, and he said he thought this was a good fit for us. We've tried several churches, as I've already mentioned before. And so I said, well, let's give it a whirl. And I came several times, and I feel very comfortable, just very at home here.
Tell me how you came to know Jesus. How did that happen?
I was raised in church. I mean, from the time I was big enough to do anything, I was three times a week, you know, Sunday night and Wednesday night. I mean, we had prayer meeting on Wednesday night. I don't know if people, they do it at different sorts of ways now, but
it's more of a small group night for us.
Yeah.
Meal and Bible study on Wednesdays.
And I was young. I was like 8-9 years old when I was called by the Lord. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I understood the gospel the way I understand it now, but I knew I loved the Lord. Mm-hmm. And I joined the church and tried to live better. Wasn't always successful, or very never successful, I guess. But anyway, I was more conscious of all of that, and that was it. And I went many years without having a church affiliation, as I said. But my son, he's 50 years old now, nearly 51, but he got to asking me some questions, and I couldn't answer them. Mm-hmm. I thought, because I profess to be a Christian, but I didn't read the Bible. I didn't do anything, you know, for a while. So I got busy, and he brought me back.
Good for your son.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Steve. And he really, I owe him a lot.
Amy, what about you? How did you come to know Jesus?
Mine's a little bit of a winding road, actually. When I was little, I had more formal Christian training in Sunday school and things like that. But that ended about when I was close to about 7 years old. And then I had touches here and there where I'd go to different churches, different religions with friends and visit them and just try things out. And that sort of experimentation kind of went on through high school and college. I can't put my finger on when Jesus really became real to me. So I can't really say I was 9 years old and it happened.
It was a process for me to get to know him.
Yeah, I did have a moment that I can't say when it was, but I know what the circumstances were. Mm. I went through something that was a trial in my life, and someone who I had been very close to became what I considered an enemy. Mm-hmm. And years later, I think it was years later, I was driving in the car, and I just had this moment where I just forgave her. Mm-hmm. And I think it was the power of what that felt like that made me go, oh. And kind of put it together. But that's really the only earth-shattering thing I went through.
That's a powerful experience. That mm-hmm. you.
Well, it must have been true forgiveness to give me that much of a jolt, but...
Yes.
It was
forgiveness was the key.
Yeah. But for the most part, I sort of consider myself I've always been sort of a laundry room Christian. So I did my praying and my talking to God and to Jesus when I was alone, either driving the car or doing the laundry, whatever. And somewhere along the line, Bob helped me to understand that that's really sort of a prideful view to think you can do it alone, that you need to share, you need to learn together. So I'm here.
And then would you tell us some ways that you want to get involved in the life of the congregation, or perhaps that you're already involved? What are some things you want to do here?
I want to do whatever I can and whatever the Lord needs me to do. I want to help the church. I want to. My main goal is, of course, to do the Lord's work, and I think the church is a good avenue to do that, obviously. And so I'm kind of wide open.
Amy, what about you? What have you thought about getting?
Well, tomorrow is my first attendance at Sarah's Circle, so I'm looking forward to that, and I'm just starting out looking for things that I could contribute to or join in. We're kind of a mixed bag of talents, so we'll have to look for opportunities that we can add to whatever's going on. Tomorrow I'm going to pack up some of my Christmas needlework and bring it in and let the ladies look at it and see if maybe that would add to some of the decorating for Christmas. And I've got some that will be new to add for next year that unfortunately is in Austin, Texas right now. So, but hopefully that can
come about.
Sounds great. I'm sure we'll find things we can contribute
with. Well, again, welcome to our family. It's a joy to be your pastor, and it's a joy to think about years that we've got to worship and serve together. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
As y'all have heard me say before, the happiest days are the days when we get to baptize folks. If you'll come stand right here, Amy. Jesus said long ago that we were to go into all the world and baptize those who would follow Him in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And baptism is symbolic. Amy's not going to go down into water. She's going to have water put on her head, symbolizing the sprinkled blood of Jesus coming down and making us clean. It's a joy to get to do this. Before too long, I'll get to baptize my future daughter-in-law. We've had infant baptisms here lately, and baptize Amy today. What a joy that is. Let's bow our heads. Oh God, thank you for Amy and for Bob. Thank you for the journey that has brought them to Highland Heights. The family members, the pastors, the friends who've taught them about Jesus. And thank you, God, that today Amy officially publicly says, yes, Jesus is my Savior and my Lord. I pray, God, that you would bless her completely and wholly, and Bob as well. And please sanctify this water to that spiritual use to which you have ordained it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amy, do you acknowledge yourself to be a sinner in the sight of God, justly deserving His displeasure, and without hope save in His sovereign mercy?
I do.
Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and the Savior of sinners? And do you receive and depend upon Him alone for your salvation as He's offered in the gospel? And then through Him, do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you sincerely repent of your sin and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will be a faithful follower of Christ, obeying God's word and showing His love all the days of your life?
I will.
Do you promise to serve Christ and His church by supporting and participating in her worship and her work to the best of your ability?
I do.
And then finally, do you submit yourself to the government and discipline of the church and promise to further her purity and her peace?
I do.
All right. Would you kneel, please? All right. Amy Bunger, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May God bless you always. Let's pray again. Oh God, what a joy it is to be surrounded by people who love you and serve you like I do. Oh God, help us to know that we're not alone in this life. It's a crazy time in our country, but you are still drawing people to yourself, to your wounded side. May Amy know beyond a shadow of a doubt for the rest of her life until you call her to heaven that you love her with a love that will never let her go. In the matchless name of Christ Jesus, amen. Get up. Good.
Good. Come on, boys.
There you go.
There you go.
Love you. Welcome. Ooh, ooh. Thank you, God. I've told Amy that since they started coming here, her smile is so encouraging. Sometimes I look out and I see this, or I see serious expressions, and I understand, we're all different. But when I look out at Amy, I see such a wonderful smile. It touches my heart. Let's go to the throne of grace. Oh God, here we are again, called by you on your day to come into your house with your people, to listen to your word, to sing your songs, to turn to you and your love for us. God, would you bring to mind to us just for a few seconds the things that we know we don't want to do again, and we turn to you asking not only for your forgiveness, but for your help so that we won't make the same mistakes. Would you hear us now? And Father, thank you for being the kind of God who is not simply high and lifted up, but a God who comes down to us in the form of a baby whose birth we will soon celebrate, who grew to become a man who taught and healed as no one else ever did or ever will again. And we thank you for your spirit that he left with us when he went to heaven. But we thank you also for human beings today who help us see the divine. Thank you, God, for men and women and boys and girls in this room and all over this planet who love us and show us that you love us even when we're unlovable. Thank you for the promise of the Christian faith, joy in this life, and eternal joy with you in heaven. And please hear us as together we pray the prayer taught to us by Jesus himself, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. gifts that God gives us is faith that we share with others. You're not alone. What do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the one holy and universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Sit where you can see the puppet show. All right. And we've got baby Eli here for the first time, right? I'm so glad to see him. He's doing great. Y'all doing well? Welcome. Welcome. Glad y'all are back. All right. I tell you what, hey, Oliver, would you come knock and let's see which puppet's here? All right, you can help him. All right, now find a seat. Okay, don't look in. Don't look in. Well, it kind of sounds like Ruth, but why is she singing Christmas stuff? Wait. It's not even December yet.
Hey, can you please come out?
Yeah, come on out, Ruth.
Oh, well, hello, Pastor Tim. Hello, boys and girls.
Hey, it's good to see you, Ruth. It's been a long time since we've seen you. Hey, and may I say you're looking as beautiful as ever?
Oh, Pastor Tim, you always say the nicest things. Oh, and yes, it has been a long time since I've been with all of you. I've missed seeing you.
Oh, we've missed seeing you, too, and I'm sure it's a lot for us to catch up on. It seems like you're in a really great mood, huh?
Oh, yes, I'm in a fantastic mood. Halloween is over. The trees are changing colors, and that can only mean one thing.
One thing? What could that be?
It's only 35 days until Christmas.
Oh, man. 35 days until Christmas?
Yes.
At our house, we're still eating leftover Halloween candy.
Oh, my.
You're starting a little early, don't you think? I mean, Ruth, it's not even Thanksgiving yet.
Oh, yes, I know. But when autumn finally comes, the leaves start changing colors, and I have to put on a sweater. Well, I just can't help it. I start decorating and singing Christmas songs. And let's not forget the Christmas shopping.
You mean you've already started your Christmas shopping?
Oh, my, yes. Why, the stores are already decorating for Christmas, and the ads in the paper, there's sales everywhere.
Well, I guess some of these boys and girls have parents that have started early on Christmas,
yes,
like you have.
Yes, yes, absolutely. But it does come with a price.
What do you mean it comes with a price?
Well, besides the credit card bills,
All
this shopping can be exhausting. My hooves are killing me.
Yeah, unfortunately, that does happen sometimes, doesn't it?
Wait, you mean your hooves hurt too?
No, that's not what I mean. Remember, I don't have hooves, I have feet.
Yes, that's right. I'm so sorry.
Well, that's okay. But while we're talking about it, this is a really busy time, the holidays, getting ready for Christmas.
Know what you mean. And every year there seems to be more and more that I have to do.
I know what you mean. It's kind of exhausting, isn't it?
Yes, but I do have a special place I like to go, and get away from all the craziness out there.
Huh, I wonder where Ruth likes to go. Maybe on a vacation at the mountains or the beach or someplace you get away?
Oh, no. It's better than that. And it just happens to be right under your hooves.
You mean my feet?
Oh, yes, I forgot.
Well,
your feet.
Well, hey, all I see under my feet is carpet.
No, I'm talking about church. Why, it's the best place to be when you want to get away from the hustle and bustle of the holidays. You know, Pastor Tim, I'm very thankful for my church.
You're right. Church is a wonderful place, and we're thankful for it because it's where we come to worship God.
That's right. And you know, I'm also very thankful for all the people who come to our church.
Oh, I am too. I mean, look around, Ruth. Isn't it great to see everybody here?
Oh, yes.
We're kind of like one big family, and really, you know, churches all over the world, we're all like one big family, and we have one thing in common.
Oh, and what would that be?
We share this belief in God, a forgiving God, who gave us a very precious gift.
Oh, yes. I remember that God's gift is the very best gift ever. God gave us His Son, Jesus. And that reminds me, Pastor Tim.
What?
Yeah, I wonder if I can, I wonder if I can remember my Bible verse I learned at Vacation Bible School.
Well, that was back in the summer. You think you can remember it?
I hope so. It's from John 3:16.
Hey, do y'all know it?
Maybe some of the boys and girls know it too.
All right, well, maybe all of us can say it together.
Oh, let's do that. Okay. For
God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. Ooh, you remember that really well, Ruth.
Good for me.
And that says it all. That's what we're most thankful for.
Yes.
And we're getting ready for Christmas when we'll celebrate the gift of that baby Jesus.
Oh, absolutely.
Hey, it sure has been good to see you. You're
gonna, it's so nice seeing you.
Are you staying for Thanksgiving lunch?
I wouldn't.
Awesome. All right. Well, let's thank God for His precious gift, okay?
Oh, yes.
We're going to put our hands together. How about you?
Oh, I'll put my hooves together.
That's what I thought. All right. Thank you, God, for these wonderful children. And please hear their prayer now as we say, Father.
Father.
I love you.
I love you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Hey, darling.
What?
We're going to be blessed with some special music from the Community of Faith Church, piano and solo, just a closer walk with thee, and we're looking forward to hearing you. Let's give our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
Pray with me, please. God, thank you for the closer walk that we have with you, daily walking with you. May that walk be increased twofold, threefold during this holiday season. And God, I thank you for every gift and every giver. Would you use them to expand your kingdom's work at the top of this hill and far beyond these walls. In the name of Jesus, amen.
And singing now, thank we all our God.
Yeah.
Please be seated. Next Sunday, I'm going to begin a sermon series I'm calling Christmas Cast. So the cast of characters in the Christmas story. Believe it or not, next Sunday is the first Sunday in Advent. But today I want to talk to you about Thanksgiving. And we'll talk about your attitude and my attitude. Seems like so many of us, including myself, are just kind of grumpy, kind of rough around the edges now. The culture seems to make us that way, and we just fall in with them. But the Bible tells us we're to have an attitude of gratitude. We read about that in Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness through all generations. And our New Testament lesson comes from 1 Thessalonians 5. We believe this is the first letter that Paul wrote, and fresh on his mind are so many hard times he's gone through, and God has taken care of him. And he writes in the 16th through the 18th verses these words, "Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." Would you bow your heads? Oh God, as we come to the close of our service and gather around your word and look forward to gathering around a table in just a moment, would you clear our minds of any worry? Would you clear our minds of any stress and anger? And instead, pour in our minds with a cornucopia gratitude, thankfulness, praise for you. In Jesus' name, amen. I read an article the other day called 7 Scientifically Proven Benefits of Gratitude. And I'm going to sort of adapt it to a Christian view of gratitude. 7 scientifically proven benefits of being grateful. Well, first of all, gratitude improves relationships. If you will do what your mama taught you to do and say thank you more often, it changes your expression, it changes other people's expression, and we have so much to be thankful for. Say thank you to somebody today, more than one person. Secondly, gratitude improves physical health. Doctors are beginning to see that the more grateful you are, the less you need high blood pressure medicine, the fewer headaches you have. Gratitude really does relate to your physical health. Third, gratitude improves spiritual health. Now, the article called it psychological health, but the things they talked about were spiritual. Gratitude improves your life. You're going to have less envy, less resentment, less depression when you're grateful. Number 4, gratitude enhances empathy and it reduces aggression. Empathy, that's caring for your fellow man. As Jesus said, love your neighbor as you love yourself. And aggression, that's less desire to get back at people. When you realize God is going to have His way, let Him take care of it. Number 5, gratitude improves sleep. Grateful people sleep better. The Christian take on this is because we know we can sleep in peace because God is always awake. The psalmist says He has no need of a nap, no need of sleep at all. God is always on watch. Number 6, gratitude improves self-esteem. I think this is an interesting one. Grateful people really do appreciate their own gifts and they appreciate the gifts of others. They're not worried about getting what somebody else has. And then number 7, gratitude reduces stress. When you understand and are grateful for the God who has you in the palm of His nail-pierced hand, you don't worry so much. It seems to me that these benefits of gratitude were very much in the life of Paul, as we read about him in the Bible. It leads me to Acts 16, verses 16 through 40. Do you know this story about Paul in the jail in Philippi? He writes short time after that, "Be joyful always, pray continually." The King James Version is "pray without ceasing," "and give thanks to God in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you and for me in Christ Jesus." Paul had an attitude of gratitude. And when he penned those words, I wonder if he wasn't remembering what happened to he and Silas when he was in a jail in the old city of Philippi. Dr. Luke, I call him Dr. Luke because he was a physician, and he wrote the book of Acts. And he tells us that these two missionaries were on the way to the synagogue to pray when they were met by a slave girl who was possessed by an evil spirit. She used it to predict the future. Notice they were on the way to the synagogue. God is going to get you to church, but the devil is going to do his best to get in the way. Isn't it true, moms, that on Sunday morning and Wednesday night, that's when you have the most trouble with your kids or your husband, getting them out of the house and getting them to church? Our children's ministry director, Lisa Hart, likes to talk about when she was a young mother raising her kids, trying to get them to church. That was when they threw up on the clothes, they wouldn't eat the food, they wouldn't get in the car, on and on it goes. So finally she'd get them in the car, she'd pull up in the church parking lot, mad as a hornet, she'd get out and somebody'd say, "Hey, how are you?" "I'm fine." Church face, but everybody else knew. You can identify with it. They're on the way to the synagogue. And for many days, Luke tells us, this girl followed them and she shouts out something interesting. She knows who they are. She shouts, "These men are servants of the Most High God. They're telling you the way to salvation, to be saved." You know, in the Gospels, we find that the demons know who Jesus is. Lots of times the people didn't. But the demons knew, and this girl knows. And finally, Paul becomes so troubled, and the sense here in the Greek is not really troubled, it's more like he's irritated. He's tired of it. And so he turns around and he says to the Spirit, "In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her." Immediately, at that moment, that evil spirit left her. But she was a slave, and it left her masters in a conundrum. She was how they made their living, and they were mad. My grandfather used to say something that I see more and more the older I get, especially when you look at what's going on in the country politically: just follow the money. And that's what happens here. When the owners of the slave girl realize that their hope of making money is gone, they seize Paul and Silas, they bring them before the authorities, and they play the race card, as is done so often these days. They say, "These men are Jews. These men are Jews. And they're throwing our city into an uproar." That wasn't the issue. It wasn't because they were Jews. They weren't doing anything to cause an uproar. But these men were about to lose their source of money. And they're mad. The mob joined in the attack against them, and the magistrates ordered that they be stripped and beaten. And after they'd been severely flogged, and the flogging here is the 39 lashes like Jesus endured, it's a wonder they lived through it. And after they're flogged, they're thrown into prison. And the jailer puts them in the inner cell where the security is the best. And he fastens their feet in stocks. And that means that they stretch their legs as far as they could stretch them without breaking them, so that they're in pain while they've been beaten, while they're bleeding, they're in jail. Now, I'm going to tell you the truth. If that had been me, I would have said, God, I'm a preacher. What's this doing? Why is this happening to me? But that's not what Paul and Silas did. In fact, it's fascinating to me that what they did at about midnight is pray and sing to God. They start praying and singing hymns. And the other prisoners, of course, are listening. They would have expected them to join in the moaning, the groaning, the complaining. Instead, they're listening. And let me tell you something. When you're going through a hard time, people who know you're Christian are watching you and they're listening to you. Are you complaining? Are you praising God in the midst of all your circumstances? People are watching us. They're listening to us. Suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the prison's foundations are shaken. In the darkness, cell doors flew open and the prisoners' chains came loose. Now understand, we had a little tremor here the other day. Did anybody feel it? A few people at early church said they did. My wife and I didn't feel it. But let me tell you something. In Philippi, they felt this earthquake. It was a major earthquake. Well, when the cell doors open and the jailer realizes what's going on, he wakes up, he sees the doors open, he draws his sword because he knows that if any one of those prisoners gets away, the Romans will kill him. And he's going to save them the trouble. He's about to kill himself. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself. We're all here." Did you hear that? What if the prison doors flew open down here at 201 Poplar or out at the penal farm? Would all the prisoners just sit there? No. You know why they wouldn't? Because nobody had been there singing hymns and praying. But all those prisoners stayed put. The jailer called for lights. Can't you just hear and see the torch as it comes in? He's amazed and he falls trembling before his prisoners, Paul and Silas. "Sirs," he says, "what must I do to be saved?" And they reply the reply that's all through the Bible that we still have to say today. It's so simple. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your family. The Christian faith is a family faith. It's not an individual faith. In America, we've gotten so wrapped up in me, 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 my, my. No. The Christian faith is for your family, not just you. Something amazing happens now. The jailer takes Paul and Silas and he washes their wounds. Our guitarist is a paramedic, our lead guitarist. And I asked him this morning, what would that have been like hours after a beating? It would have been horrible. Crusted blood, infection setting in, broken bones. And then the jailer and his family are baptized. The old early church father, Chrysostom, said the washing was reciprocal. Isn't that beautiful? As the jailer washed their wounds, they then poured water on the heads of the family and washed their wounds. The jailer brought them into his house and he fed them. And he was filled with joy because he and his family had come to believe in God. How is it in your family? Are you worshiping with your wife, with your husband, with your kids, your grandkids? You're going to see some folks at Thanksgiving who don't come to church. It may be because they're scared of the virus. It may be because they've just gotten out of the habit. But I think it's on you and it's on me to invite them back to church. The Christian faith is a family faith. Paul learned to give thanks in all circumstances. And it makes me think about the first Thanksgiving after my mom died. It was the hardest thing that I have ever gone through, losing my mama. The whole family felt that. There was just a hole in our family. And as we circled up to pray before we ate, I did something I'd never done before, and I asked everyone to name something they were thankful for. And I did that because we desperately needed to share with each other how God was still loving on us. And we'll do that this Thursday when my family gathers at my house, all of us, and I'll ask everybody to say something they're thankful for. Maybe you want to do that in your family. Because it is true, in all circumstances, we're to give thanks. Because Paul says in another place in the book of Romans, we know that in all things, not just in the good things, in all things, God works good for those who love Him and have been called according to His purpose. So let me ask you, how's your attitude? Do you have an attitude of gratitude? This Thanksgiving and really every day, let's give thanks to the Lord in all circumstances. Amen. Let's bow our heads. God, thank You for being the giver of all good gifts. Chief among them, the faith You've given us in the Lord Jesus Christ. In His matchless name, amen. Son was just telling me that George Linder, one of our church members, fell in the kitchen. He was helping cut up the turkey. They've had to call paramedics, so they need us to stay out of the fellowship hall for a few minutes. So I think we're going to sing one more hymn. Chiquita, pick out a hymn, you and Lauren. And then we'll visit. We've got a new baby to see and love on, and we've got Amy and Bob. I'll ask them to come down after that. The second hymn, and you'll get to meet new members. But let's pray for George right now, and then we'll sing the hymn. Oh God, thank You for George and for Janice and the sweet love that they have brought to our church since they became members a few years ago. I thank you, God, that even though George is really having trouble getting around, he wanted to help in the kitchen today, cutting up the turkey. And so, God, would you take care of him? Thank you for paramedics and all those first responders. Good Lord, we thank you for doctors and nurses and all those who take care of us. And we pray you would help George to be well quickly. We pray that you would take care of us now as we sing. We're going to sing one more hymn, and we thank you for the food we're about to eat, those who grew it, those who prepared it, those who will help clean up. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to get old school hymn books.
And we're going to join together and sing Count Your Blessings. 563.
When upon life's billows you are tempted.